invite everyone to take your seat for the beginning of the change of commands of the Bedford Minutemen Company. Mike Rosenberg, and honored to be serving as the master of ceremonies this evening. I want to welcome all of you on behalf of the town, and at this time we'll commence the annual change of command. Welcome to the 55th Annual Change of Command Ceremony of the Bedford Minuteman Company. On behalf of the Selectmen, as Chair, I have the distinction of serving as the Honorary Commander of the Company. At their recent annual meeting, the Minutemen elected officers for the coming year. So I would now like to introduce outgoing Captain James McGinn to proceed with the remainder of the ceremony.
Good evening. My name is James McGinn, the captain of the Bedford Minuteman Company. Wish to welcome everyone here tonight. And I'd like to introduce the current incoming captain of the Bedford Minuteman Company, Captain Chuck Hackler. The captain of the Bedford Minuteman Company wears a red cockade. Back in the time, that was so the captain stood out and his men knew where the captain was. So I will give the red cockade over to the new captain, Chuck Hackler. Also, the captain gets the sword. As well as the gorget. And last, the official orders, making Captain Hackler the official captain on paper.
Please be seated. Before we continue with the ceremony, I'd like to take a minute to talk about our dear member, Mike Hand, who we lost earlier this month. Mike was in line to be captain starting last year, but as his time was approaching, he was beginning to have difficulty marching. He didn't know it at the time, but he was in the early stages of ALS. Jim McGinn and I agreed to take Mike's place and serve as captain during his term. Mike was a beloved member of our company and always had a warm smile and a good sense of humor. He passed away earlier this month. He is greatly missed and will be fondly remembered. Let's now pause for a moment in Mike's memory. Thank you. We will now continue with the installation of officers. First Lieutenant. The First Lieutenant serves as temporary captain during the absence of the captain and serves as the MC at pole capping. Elected to the rank of First Lieutenant, James McGinn. Second Lieutenant Adjutant. The Second Lieutenant Adjutant notifies all members of musters and meetings, records and keeps permanent minutes of the meetings, and handles company correspondence. Elected to the rank of Second Lieutenant Adjutant, Roy Kring. Second Lieutenant Finance. The Second Lieutenant Finance serves as the company treasurer, collects dues from members, pays bills owed by the company, and reports the state of finances at the monthly meetings. Elected to Second Lieutenant Finance, Richard Manley. Cornet. The cornet is the keeper and bearer of the Bedford flag. The cornet carries the flag in all parades and leads the Concord parades, the Merriam's Corner, and on Patriots Day. Elected to the rank of cornet, Peter Secor. Peter was unable to make it today. Sergeant Major. The Sergeant Major commands the musket men and ensures that they are properly drilled and that their muskets are in safe working order. Elected to the rank of Sergeant Major, Marla Flynn. Marla was also not able to make it tonight. Sergeant Quartermaster. The Sergeant Quartermaster is the custodian of the company property, issues proper colonial attire, procures items to sell, and maintains a record of the inventory. Elected to the rank of Sergeant Quartermaster, Jeanette Papier. Executive Board. The Executive Board, along with the Captain, guide the company. Members of the Executive Board are past captains themselves. Elected to the Executive Board, James Ringwood. This concludes our installation of officers. Thank you for attending. This ceremony will be immediately followed by the Citizen of the Year presentation.
Bring his honors to the new captain.
Huzzah! 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 Huzzah!
Attention. Forward march.
So blessed to have that as part of our traditions. If John Filios walks through that door, I won't even be surprised. Before I begin, I want to personally, on behalf of all of us, thank Town Manager Sarah Stanton and her dedicated staff for all the behind-the-scenes work that resulted in tonight's event. I truly feel blessed to be in a position to preside at tonight's program. I've known Jeff Hoyland, our Citizen of the Year, since he was a high school student. I'm so cognizant of all that he's done in so many ways for so long, and I hope to share that with you now with as much of a personal touch as makes sense. Many times I tell people, even if they don't want to know, that Bedford is truly fortunate to be part of a military community because military personnel have a culture of giving back. And many of them are stationed here and then they stay here. And then they contribute to the quality of life in ways that are innumerable and that inspire others to do the same. And the Hoylands were a military family. 8 siblings, and they bounced around like that's what happens. But Jeffrey was fortunate enough to spend all 4 years at one high school in Bedford. And the interesting thing is that he was a student athlete, but he also was active in the musicals. I've always been proud of the high school accommodating people involved with athletics and other interests. I've also thought it was important to be in the musicals. Now, those of you who don't believe Jeff played football, and he was a track star, and he was a football player. But you can pass this around. Number 84 in the first row. My wife says, "Why do you save so much stuff?" You never know. So he went on to the University of Florida, as many of you know. After 3 years there, he finished up his undergraduate education at Northeastern, degree in business entrepreneurship. Now Jeff was involved with a dynamic video production business in North Cambridge that I patronized myself in the late 90s. And he had a sense of what was to come in that area of media. So he married Randy in 1993, and along came Alex and Sienna. And I thought Jeff was going to be involved deeply in local government because he got on the Community Preservation Committee for several years around 2001. And they also lived on a street, Sherwood Drive, in the shadow of 2 iconic political personalities, Martha Hu and Shelley Moore. It's a very short street, so it's kind of hard to get away from. So doesn't this sound like a situation comedy? Young couple, 2 children growing up in a suburban street, successful business, community service, and what's going to be on the next week's episode? So. Unfortunately, the next week's episode is the second part of the biography. And Jeff Hoyland was diagnosed with tongue cancer in 2010. Of course, as soon as you're diagnosed, then you become a survivor. and he still is. And over the years, the battle became more complicated, and it continued. Over the past 9 years, Jeff has been transformed physically so that he can stay alive. He lost the ability to speak and to swallow, and he made so many trips to Dana Farber that the homeless guys down at the end of Alewife Brook Parkway at Route 2, they held up signs that say, "Jeff, get well soon." I saw one today. So right away, the community rallied to help the Hoyland family in any way they needed. You know, delivering food, helping with stuff around the house, making sure the kids were where they needed to go. And Jeff could have stayed home, crawled into the fetal position, and tried to survive the next day. And nobody would have said that he was wrong. But instead, he not only reinvented himself, but he became a significant contributor to the quality of life for hundreds of people in Bedford, continuing to this moment. And don't think that he's going to go home and say, "Oh, I'm citizen of the year, I'm going to stop." He's just going to shift into another gear. Now, the key to this chapter, I think, is technology. Not the medical technology, that's a different story, but the communications tools known as social media. Some of you know that for years, Jeff has maintained a blog called The Art of Being Better and a companion Facebook page that he calls 100 Meals You Never Thought You Would Eat Pureed, Recipes for Head and Neck Cancer Patients. The entries, though, are not just recipes, but valuable personal advice for living a quality life based on Jeff's own unfortunate experience. But then there's a Facebook group that Jeff manages that some of you probably are members of called Team Good Morning. Let me read to you the description of this group because it's inspiring. This group is for people who want to move beyond posting positive messages on Facebook and want to impact people's lives by keeping a positive force in daily life. So every morning, say good morning to everyone you see, especially those who are not looking at you or expecting it. Not only will it start a positive ripple across the universe, it also helps fight cancer, because it turns out people who are in a good mood have better immune systems which fight off disease. Members are allowed to post both stories and social media of people stepping out of their comfort zone and being kind to their neighbors, one person at a time. Amazing. But wait, there's more. About 6 years ago, Jeff launched another Facebook page called Bedford Snapshots. Anybody ever seen that? He started out photographing local landmarks and then shooting high school sporting events and practices and posting the pictures online, more and more, innumerable. Not just varsity sports, but middle school sports and recreation sports, and then other youth and community events, until he seemed to be in almost as many places as Julie Turner. But actually, Jeff works in tandem with the Bedford Citizen on many of his photographs, and Bedford Snapshots has over 1,800 followers. Jeff's activity on Facebook, not everybody's a Facebook fan, I think there are many more pluses than minuses, and here's an example. Jeff's activity on Facebook is unpredictable and entertaining and meaningful. Well, what do I mean? He has conversations with his camera. And fascinating. He shares song lyrics. He makes random observations, any one of which can cause the reader to stop and think and reconsider something. Like this. In high school, I had to do a book report on a book that influenced me. I did it on The Sneetches by Dr. Seuss. The teacher was surprised, but I bet none of you are. So I think that you all can appreciate what a unique opportunity we have right in our midst to salute someone who, well, the best way to put it is there a certificate that I'm supposed to present?
It's on the table.
It's on the table. I want to read what it said because I wrote this. But it's from the heart. So, don't come up yet, because Sharon McDonald's gonna, Sharon here? I hope. She has a presentation, but I want to read this. In recognition of his profound contributions to the community, exemplified by prolific and exquisite photography, and inspired by creativity, optimism, and resilience, Jeffrey Hoyland is awarded the distinguished honor of being named Citizen of the Year 2019. Seriously, is a town historian here? No? Did give her a call? Maybe she forgot. Okay, so when Sharon comes in, I'll stop whatever I'm doing because she had something to say also. But meanwhile, there's gift baskets. I guess I'll just announce what's in it, and then you can figure out where it is and back up a truck to the. Make sure you don't use the front door. The state has agents outside to make sure nobody walks in the front door. So here's what is in the gift basket. And some of these I think you'll end up giving to your friends and relatives, but everything was donated with great admiration and generosity. Homemade goods, gift certificates, Bedford memorabilia, including Bedford Farms gift certificate.
Yeah.
And and it says hat and fleet sweatshirt given by Bedford Farms. I think that might be a flavor. And then of course from the DPW, Bedford flag, not the original, but I was gonna say a replica, but Ann Ringwood's father, John Ahern, of blessed memory, would never let me use replica. Because he said a replica has to be thread for thread. It's a reproduction. Then we have something that no local household should be without. The book by Louise Brown, the former town historian, a revolutionary town. Also, this and other gifts from the Historical Society include a Bedford flag paperweight and the town of Bedford hat, which I have to find out if I can get one. Friends at the Depot Park have a special mug with the insignia of the Bedford Barica narrow gauge on it. Then, Great Road Gallery and Framing gift certificate, Lincoln Liquors gift certificate, Salon Reina gift certificate, T.L. Nails pedicure gift certificate, Bedford Jewelers, our friends there, feel like I should be giving out scholarships to them. And several of our food purveyors, Be Good, Flatbread, Great Wall, Starbucks, Ken's New York Deli, Red Heat Tavern, Subway, all very generous, and a certificate for lunch or dinner for two at Carlton Willard Village. Now, all of these, I think, are over on the table. People are welcome to admire them. And I just feel like if every commercial and nonprofit in town had a gift for you, it doesn't come close to the gift that you've given us. So now I'll give you the certificate. So through the miracles of science and technology, Jeff's going to say some words in acceptance. And I leave it entirely in your hands.
Go to the basket.
What a crazy year this has been. I share my little piece of heaven that I call the town of Bedford. Thank you, and you, and you, and you, and you, and you, and you. Before I get started here, I need to thank several people: Dana Goldman, Ross Goldman, John, and Barbara Moss. Through all the insanity we call cancer treatment, they have always made sure that my family is taken care of, and we have had plenty of family vacation time to cherish. I brought two of my best friends to help me with my presentation. I'd like to turn the mic over to my best friends Chip and Bill.
Good evening, my name is Bill Kennerson and I'm honored to be one of Jeff's voices tonight. I met Jeff at the University of Florida our freshman year. Even then, Jeff was always encouraging us to push our boundaries. For example, Jeff convinced a bunch of us friends it would be a great idea to drive to West Virginia on a whim to watch a University of Florida women's volleyball game. Because that's what fans do. Soon after Jeff moved back to the Boston area, I moved up from Florida. My wife, Betsy, and Jeff's wife, Randy, were high school friends, and our children went to school together here in Bedford. Before long, Jeff and Randy had bought a house in Bedford in 1994. The house held some special memories for Jeff because he had partied in it back in high school. This is something that Randy doesn't know. Well, didn't know. In 2000, I joined a business networking organization called BNI. I invited Jeff to a meeting because I thought it'd be right up his alley. Little did I know it would change his life. He learned two new mantras: why be average when exceptional is an option, and no one cares how much you know until they know how much you care. Think about it. Why be average when exceptional is an option? This wonderful phrase can apply to anything, including how well we show each other our love and kindness. No one cares how much you know until they know how much you care is a little harder to do. Sometimes you have to let someone fail before they're ready to listen to advice. Jeff has built up a trust with the students and athletes he photographs. He promises them he won't post an ugly picture of them. This trust allows him to drop pieces of advice when he sees a student has lost confidence or is frustrated. The advice always starts out the same. Jeff types out a message: are you open for a suggestion? And then a conversation ensues. He's taken the time to show them how much he cares. I think he's shown all of us how much he cares. about those in front of the camera, his friends and family, and his town. And we see it every day on that little Facebook page he calls Bedford Snapshots.
All right. Always look on the bright side of life. Good evening, my name is Chip Newman, and I was honored when Jeff asked me to be one of his voices. Jeff and I spent our formative high school years together in a small town called Bedford. Jeff was conceived on Annette Island, Alaska, and born in the Presidio, San Francisco, California. Captain Bernard and Peggy Hoyland moved Jeff and family to Miami, Florida, Astoria, Oregon, Agana, Guam, West Hollywood, Florida, and Traverse City, Michigan. Then in 1975, they brought their 8 children to Bedford because it was close to Hanscom. When the Hoylands moved into a neighborhood, they became the neighborhood. Jeff had found his home. In the BHSU book, Jeff's quote was, "Jack of all trades, master of none." Jeff was known for playing football, starring in musicals, running track, and dungeon mastering the local Dungeons and Dragons game. Too many late nights. Jeff floated easily from one group to another. Although Jeff didn't play a musical instrument, he could just as easily be found after school in the band room. Jeff and I both worked at Denny's in Lexington. Yeah, there was a Denny's in Lexington at one point. good times. There's one busboy there named Greg Kengdon. Greg was so good and so efficient, he was the envy of everyone who worked with him. He created a way to stack dirty dishes in a bus tub that became known as the Kemptonium. This was the first time Jeff got to see why be average when exceptional is an option. I am most pleased to say that high school with Jeff in the 70s was so much better because we didn't have digital cameras. The younger Jeff would have taken much glee in posting pictures which should have never been posted. A battle I still face. He scans a lot of old pictures. Now that digital images are important in high school as math or English, Jeff makes sure that students who do the extracurricular activities have pictures that the students are proud to share. And just one more quick note, a note to camera. Phone's got this one. Come on. So if you all just smile for me. There we go. All right, you can look for that on Bedford Snapshots.
And yet you are. reinforces my daughter's conspiracy theory that there are shadow organizations controlling the world behind my back. You didn't have to show up, yet you did. I want to thank all the teen parents who keep activities of this town running smoothly, from bands, to sports, to scouting. A special shout out to the parents of the 2016 DCL champion volleyball team, who coordinated their efforts to pick me up and drive me to matches. They were one of the first ones to realize that having Mr. Hoyland on the sidelines was worth an extra 4 points per set. You didn't have to do that, and yet you did. I want to thank Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Facebook gave me a free way to share photos. When I see that relatives from Iraq, Vietnam, Guam, Italy, etc. are commenting they love the photographs, I knew I had something special going on. I come from a military family, so I know that most of the military families in Bedford have their relatives in other parts of the world. I want to thank Peter Parker, whose uncle told him, with great power comes great responsibilities. When I went through radiation the first time, I didn't get a superpower. When I went through radiation a second time, I didn't realize I had my superpower until this year. My superpower is the ability to bring people together through kindness. I have a bunch of helpers. All the parents who tag other parents on my Facebook page. I am able to connect one small Bedford group with other groups. Maybe I am like a bumblebee and help cross-pollinate the volunteers in Bedford. I'm a 9-year survivor. I'm on my third bout with cancer, and I still have a several-year life expectancy. The people of Bedford stepped up in a big way to help me and my family when I first got cancer. I want to thank the neighbor brigade, who made sure that I was able to get rides to all my appointments. You didn't have to volunteer to drive me, and yet you did. When I went on medical disability, I needed to fill up my day and also get some fresh air and physical exercise. I want to thank the Bedford Local Transit, who gave me the ability to get to the high school for a buck, and then lift it home later. Which meant I could photograph whatever activities were happening at BHS and JGMS. And there is almost always something going on. Not every parent can make it to school activities, but I can. And I'd want someone to do it for me if they could. I want to thank the Bedford Free Public Library for giving me a dry, warm place to recharge when I run low of energy. Sometimes, I get to take pictures in the historical books room. In the winter, this is a great place to take camera and connect Bedford of the past with Bedford of the future. I want to thank all the taxpayers of Bedford who realize that rehabbing an old building for modern uses is a wise idea. You realize that new stage lighting and sound systems are important. You realize a turf field is a good option. I want to thank all the parents of Bedford Youth Baseball and Softball, who let me wander around the diamonds in the center of town taking pictures of their children. The best compliment I ever got was one athlete whispering to another athlete, "Hey, that's the guy who takes pictures of the varsity teams." I want to thank all the parents who engage in group activities like dance, bands, softball, hockey, etc. You are great role models to show the students that life is more than just making money. You have to make time to live. You don't have to play, and yet you do. I want to thank everyone who contributes to fundraiser raffles. I am a sucker for a great gift basket, although my wife Randy might frown when I bring home a giant basket of candies. Oops, it happens. You didn't have to donate, and yet you did. I want to thank the Bedford Citizen who lets me freely tag them on my Twitter posts. Traditional news sources are covering local events less and less, and the Bedford Citizen is bucking that trend. I want to thank every student slash athlete who ever set a personal best time or distance. I go the distance, because you go the distance. Especially the athletes on winter track. Boston is an ugly place to drive to get to a high school event, so I make the trip for their parents. I want to thank Bedford for supporting a robust theatrical community. I love attending the dress rehearsals and being able to run from one spot in the audience to another so that I can create terrific pictures of the performances. I want to thank every person who cried when they viewed my photographs. I plan to do it again in the future. I want to thank every grandparent who said that is so precious. I share on Facebook, because it is an easy way for grandparents to see their grandkids. I want to thank the webmaster at Bedford High School Parent Association. I never tag BHSPA with any of my posts out of respect to not clutter up their social media, and yet every day they pick one or two of my posts to retweet. I want to thank the founding fathers of the United States who unanimously agree they are endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. I have chosen to focus on the pursuit of happiness. I know there are still people in the audience who are trying to figure out who the other 6% of people who are not donating time to the town of Bedford. Most of these people were invited by me, so let me single a few out. Dorothy Hoyland is here from Stoneham. Anytime I post that it's time for another trip into Dana Farber, I receive a text from her, "Do you need any help?" She's got my back. Dorothy was married to my brother, Alan, who died several years ago. Alan was one of my chief mentors in life. He was one of the kindest people I know. David and Ruth Milam from Lakeville couldn't be here, but I wanted to mention them. David is rector at Church of Our Savior Episcopal. 8 years ago, David responded to one of my posts online with the comment, "Maybe God isn't done with you yet." At that point in my life, I realized God and I could make a pretty good team, together. It's worked out pretty well so far, don't you think? My sister, Karen Raver, and her daughter Catherine came up from Atlanta. I wouldn't be here without Karen. Karen is one of my favorite examples of a kind role model. She understands that responsibility is just, given my abilities, how can I respond? Karen always filters that through love, although I am checking Catherine's face to see if she will roll her eyes. The best memory I have of Karen is from back when I was in elementary school in Florida. I was selected to play a bongo solo for the daytime school Christmas choir performance. No one in my family could make it. Karen was able to get out of middle school to come watch. I saw her in the audience. It made my day. She didn't have to show up, and yet there she was. Finally, I'd like to thank my wife who lets me wander around town, unescorted. She lets me post online, unescorted. When Randy isn't at work, you can find her in her beautiful garden doing the gardening. On days when I am not feeling... as strong, I love to walk around her garden. It makes me happy. If she is home when I am headed out the door to photograph an event, the last thing I hear from her is, "Have fun, Daddy. You be you." So to all the people I have mentioned, thank you. For everyone in this room, you didn't have to be here, and yet here you are, and for that, I thank you very much.
Program. I just have to note, though, a historical peculiarity. When I think Chip mentioned that Jeff used to spend time in high school in the music room, and what was going on was he met up with some amateur musicians from the student body, and they'd go in and jam once a week, and that became known as Jeff Sessions. I'm sure Jeff would love to receive your individual best wishes. Make sure you finish all the food. You didn't have to be here, but I'm so glad you were. I have a request from the Bedford Citizen for all past Citizens of the Year and current to meet in front of the podium for a class picture.
I am.
Thank you.